set time to the holy. Speak up with thy love. Abide in him always, and feed on his word. Make friends of God's children. Help those who are weak, forgetting in nothing his blessing to seek. Take time to be holy. The world rushes on. Spend much time in secret with Jesus alone. By looking to Jesus, like him thou shalt be. Thy friends in thy conduct his likeness shall see. Take time to be holy. Let him be thy guide, and run not before him, whatever betide, in joy or in sorrow. Still follow thy Lord, and looking to Jesus, still trust in his word. Take time to be holy. Be calm in thy soul. Each thought and each temper beneath his control. Thus, led by his Spirit to fountains of love, thou shalt soon be fitted for service above.
Almighty Father, you are ready to tell us your words and to bless us, to equip us for the ministry, to make your grace sufficient for us. Father, speak to your people and let their eyes open. Those who are not qualified, tell them so. If they desire to serve you, God, qualify them and give them your ministry. Those whose ministries are dying, God, quicken them again, renew them, and give them sufficient grace to run the ministry. Those that are doing well, encourage them, commend them in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. These are ministers you're training for the last day's revival. We are very, very grateful to be part of it, part of them. Worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. You can be seated. We are considering at this time divine grace and ministry for you. Divine grace and ministry for you. God will give you grace to do his ministry. He will give you ministry as you desire. He has qualification for ministry. If you desire it and commit yourself to him, God will qualify you. The scripture prescribes the standard required for the Christian ministry. For the Christian minister desiring to enter into the Christian ministry, God's service is the highest service that must be embarked upon with great care and fear. Not everybody in the church is qualified for the Christian ministry. As the scripture says, the harvest is plenteous and the laborers are few. Yes, but only God can add to the laborers. See it in Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9. The Bible tells us in verse 36 to 38, saying, but when he saw the multitudes, He was moved with compassion on them because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Then said he unto his disciples, can we read that together? 1, 2, go. The harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. 38. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. Is there anybody that is more compassionate on sinners than God himself? Is there anybody that knows the shortness of time that the end shall come than God himself? Yet he does not want you to send laborers into his field. It is himself that should send it. He doesn't want you to do that. He does not want you to just rush in as because the harvest is plenteous. No. He has standard for the work. He has standard. Back again to Gideon's army. He said, announce that the 32,000 people are too many for me to smite the Midianites that were as many as the sand in the seashore. Tell them those who are afraid should go back. And that Gideon never knew that some were afraid. It was until God revealed it. Majority of the people went back. Majority. God does not see as man sees. Man does not see as God sees. God, man looks unto the outward appearance, but God looketh into the heart. He said, go and announce to them. It surprised Gideon that more than half left and went back. It didn't trouble God. Was not God interested for the Midianites to be defeated for his people? Yes, he was. Was not God interested for army that will go to defeat these Midianites for his people? Yes, he was. But why is he asking this majority to go back? They will spoil the battle. They will not follow the standard. They are not qualified. They will not listen to the Holy Spirit. They will do it carnally. Because they are not called for it. 10,000 people that came up. He said, still take them to the river. I'm going to try them there. This is what I am doing for myself. I am the God that promised you this battle. I'm not doing it after the nations of the world. There is a difference because I am involved here. Take them to the river, to the water. I'm going to try them. And this is how you should find out to know who they are. This is how you should find out to know who they are. Then they took them to the river. How many of them were taken to the river? How many? 10,000. And by the standard of God, how many qualified? 300. Although the harvest is plenteous, please don't rush into it. There is the owner of the harvest. It is who he chooses or whom he chooses, whom he calls, that goes there. The Bible says, and Jesus said this, pray ye to the owner of the harvest that he, not you, he, not you, I'm going to tell you why things spoiled. Things spoiled because ministers, I told you that you were walking in the flesh. You were appointing people after the flesh. You ceased to know the quality of harvest God was looking for. You were looking for multitudes when he's sending away the multitudes. And so you sent every Dick and Harry. And the work is spoiled and is stunted. You are seeing crowd, but you can't find grain inside the chaff. Not for heaven. But this qualitative mean would have done better. How many people filled the world with the gospel of Jesus after the ascension of Jesus? He gave 12 apostles. 11, one replaced 12. And these were able to bring the revival that is in the world today. Follow the path of God. Let the revival that we are looking for come forth. Follow his path. Look at it in the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 5 verse 4. The Bible says, and no man taketh this honor unto himself, but he that is called of God, as was Aaron. No man taketh this honor. I love that title, Pastor, Reverend. I love that title, General Overseer. And so you go to start a church? Who asks you to do it? You, on your own accord, you are climbing through the window. You are not following by the door, through the door. No man, no man taketh this honor unto himself, but he that was called of God, that is called of God. Even the services in the church, it's not for you to just assume anyone you want to do and be just doing. Do you qualify? I know you have some talents, because everybody is born with a talent, natural talent. Some are naturally talented to be zealous by nature, not really born again. Anything they enter into, they do with zeal. They are talented to be workmen. Any work they see, they want to do. They are talented to sing. They easily compose songs. They easily do this. But for God, it's not talent, but him that calls. It's him that calls. Not talent. Don't rise up and say, I have the talent. I know how to do this. I know how to do this. No. Him that is called of God. For he knows whom he calls. He knows whom he calls. So that's what the Lord wants us to know. You must qualify for the ministry. I speak to you, number one, qualification for the Christian ministry. Qualification for the Christian ministry. Qualification for the Christian ministry. Now, many people are into ministry today who are not called by God. By their lives and character, they are not qualified to be ministers of the Holy God. Since they were not called, they don't have a message for the people. So, cannot benefit the people of God at all. They do not achieve anything for God. Look at it in Jeremiah chapter 23. Jeremiah chapter 23 verse 14. The Bible tells us here, saying, I have seen also in the prophets of Jerusalem an horrible thing. They commit adultery and walk in lies. They strengthen also the hands of evildoers, that none doth return from his wickedness. They are all of them unto me as Sodom, and the inhabitants thereof as Gomorrah. Can you see? I have seen also in the prophets of Jerusalem an horrible thing. They commit adultery. Is God the one that called them? They commit adultery. They walk in lies. And the Lord declared concerning these people. He declared concerning these people that he has not called them. Yes. He has never called them. He is not involved in their ministry. Look at it in verse 21. He is not involved. I have not sent these prophets. Yet they run. Please, let's stop the people clapping hands over there. I have not sent these prophets. Yet they run. I have not spoken to them. Yet they prophesied. Can you see that? God is saying, I have not sent them. I have not spoken to them. Now, God didn't send you. God didn't send you. And you wrong. God never gave you the message. You wrong. Which way will you benefit the people? What message do you have? That you are just there. You have gathered people. You know how to gather them. For politicians also gather people. You have gathered them. What message do you have? And you have written a signboard and called it a church. What message do you really have? Are you wiser than God? Are you more compassionate than God? Surely you went for yourself. You went for yourself. And you too, that are sending people. Have you verified them? Go and be pastor here. Is it God that asks you to send them? Or you want expanse of your church? Actually, it's your church, not God's church. For God's own church is not everybody that can pastor him. He called them. If that church must be by God, then you must pray hard to know whom God will choose to be where, to do what. I have not spoken to them, but they run. Where are they running to? How will they benefit the people? Look at it in verse 31 and 32. Behold, I am against the prophets, saith the Lord, that use their tongues and say, he saith. Behold, I am against them that prophesy false dreams, saith the Lord, and do tell them and cause my people to err by their lies and by their lightness. Yet I sent them not, nor commanded them. Therefore, they shall not profit these people at all, saith the Lord. I didn't send them. I'm saying this because you must discover your foundation. Your foundation is out of course. Maybe the ministry now is being frustrated. You can't move forward. You can't do what the Lord has never called you to be, a general overseer. Discover it on time and go back and do restitution. Go back and amend your ways. Go back. Otherwise, the frustration will never be taken away. You have not discovered your proper function. You're into a wrong thing altogether. The Lord has not been there all these years. Your life does not qualify. Your life doesn't qualify, because there is qualification for Christian ministry. It's not everybody. The people that should carry the ark of the covenant were called, anointed, prepared. It's not everybody that will take that ark. Not everybody that will carry that ark. Any other person that is not prepared, that carries that ark, judgment will go forth against him. Fear the Lord. Fear the Lord. Midianites were as the sun in the seashore. But only few, 300, did it. Why not back up behind these 300? If the Lord has called 300 overseers, why don't you back up and support them? Why are you forwarding yourself when the Lord has not forwarded you? Why are you forwarding yourself when the Lord has not given you? Until we abandon the work and go into competition, the devil that takes advantage. Some are going up, some are coming down, hitting yourselves on the way and affecting this work. Why? Because you will not follow the formula. Be informed also that there is no eternal security with God's call. You can be called yesterday and rejected today. Is that so? Because there's qualification. There is qualification. You can't boast, yes, in fact, I did this, I did that yesterday. It is me that did that. Are you keeping the faith? Are you keeping the righteousness? Or you think that it is as if it's an employment you got for life? It's a tree you planted. I was all planted this tree, so I must eat the fruit of it all the time. Mass? No. No eternal security in Christian service. You must qualify to continue. The moment you backslide, the ministry stops. If you continue, you're just dragging, as Pharaoh was dragging the chariots under the sea, for the wheels have been taken away by God. You're just dragging. So we the preach are very careful. Very careful over our lives. Yes, it is the choice of God that made me the international director. But I must qualify every day. Otherwise, mystery can happen. I may not be the international director tomorrow. This is Christian. Jesus said, my Father loves me because I do always those things that please him. But backsliding, you're still there. Is that the ministry of God? No. I mean, the vision left us. That's why the church died. The church eventually became a business. You started it. You hand it over to your family member, to your wife, to your children. Are they called? That's business you're doing. Did Moses hand over to his children? Did he hand over to his wife? Did he hand over to a relation? But they that are called, Moses prayed and the Lord said, Joshua. It's Joshua. Even Moses didn't know. It's God that, the work is God's work. Appointment is from him. Don't play politics over appointment. It's from God. Don't play in my eyes. If I play like that, he will give me this. You are a man, your color. Look to God. It comes from him. And if God means it, that you should, you will do it. He will open a way for you. He will give you the appointment. And how it will happen is beyond the knowing of man. You will be where God wants you to be. What God is looking for, qualify. Qualify. Don't seek it after the flesh. Qualify. Control yourself. Yeah, I want to do ministry. I want to, but control yourself. Control yourself. Take it to God in prayer, for we do not know the time and the season. They are in God's hands. Please, let's be orderly to give beauty to this service. Let you human being, you're making your recommendations. Is that divine recommendation? Have you prayed about it? Did you call on God to say, God, who? And the Lord gave a person very clear. Did you? Or you're going on political thing? You're going on social thing? Not qualification of God. This thing requires qualification. And the person that chooses is not man, but God that seeth the heart. That's what we need to know. Look at it in the book of Romans, chapter 10. Romans chapter 10, verse 13 to verse 13. It says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Then, series of questions followed that assertion, that declaration. Whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord, what shall happen to him? But that is followed by the following questions in verse 14. Number one, how then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? How are they going to call upon the name of Jesus? They have not believed on him, so they cannot call upon him. So the salvation cannot come to them. Salvation cannot come to them because they have not believed on the Lord Jesus. How can they? Then the second question, and how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? How? They have not even heard about him. How will they now believe? It is when they hear that their ear will taste those words. Their ears will try those words. Their heart will think upon those words. Then they will take decision and believe on him. But they have no heart. How then can they believe? Question number three. And how shall they hear without a preacher? This tells the place of the preacher. How shall they hear without a preacher? Many people therefore come forth. I am a preacher. I am going out to preach. I have a church. I have opened a ministry. I am a preacher. The people will hear me. The people will believe. It's not everybody that will preach. It's not everybody. See it again. In verse 15. And how shall they preach except they be sent? It's not every preacher. I'm telling you, many of you are wasting your time and energy. The Lord has not sent you. I have not sent these prophets, but they run. Where are they running to? Well, how will they be of profit to my people? I've not sent them. He that is sent has the message. Yes, when Absalom was defeated, and news needed to be taken to David, the Lord called a particular person and say, you will go and tell King David that this is what has happened. The Lord has given the victory to you. There is this young man that can run very well. He didn't hear because he was not very clear what is happening. They say, oh, news. Oh, there's a message going to David. I will run and tell David. Tell David what? You were not sent. He ran. Tidings, king. Tidings. Yes. What is the tidings? Well, I saw some people gathered somewhere. I cannot understand actually how the whole thing is. Ah, you don't have a message. Go to the other side. The later the man that has the had the message was coming. He has the message. He has the message. When he came, tidings, okay. Yes, come. Where's the tidings? Joab said, I should tell you this. That's the message. You are running. God has not sent you. What message? Are you using your pride for things that are divine? Things that are spiritually designed. You want to run it in carnal way? What? You want to run it in carnal way? Ahab told Jehoshaphat that they should go for battle. He should help him. Then 400 prophets of Baal came and said, go, the Lord is with you. Ahab was not convinced of these people. He asked him, is there no other prophet of God here that we should inquire of? There is one, though it's not palatable one. Let him come. Don't say so, king. Don't say so. Let him come. And he gave the word. Again, can you see? Another king was telling the king of Samaria, is there no man of God here? Prophet of God here. That when we inquire of, they asked, they said, there is Elisha, the son of Shaphat, that poured water in the hands of Elijah. Ah, the word of God is with him. He served with that man of God. He lived with that man of God. He walked about with that man of God. The spirit of Elijah will be in him. The word of the Lord is with him. Let's call him. So, it's not everybody. Come back. Retrace your steps for a better future. Use the remaining time to correct yourself so that you will strengthen the things that remain, that are ready to die. Why? You don't have the message. Why? You were not called. Humble yourself and follow others. This spirit that rejects followership is dangerous to the kingdom of God. The multiplied dreams and visions that the devil is spreading, appearing in the name of Jesus, multiplied prophecies that Satan is giving them now, showing you, I saw myself here, I saw myself there. Check out, a lot of those things are not from God. Satan, the author of confusion, wants to get you out. Scripture has standard of the Christian ministry. Dreams must be confirmed by the scripture. Angelic appearance must be confirmed by the scripture. Whatever vision you have seen, oh, somebody saw you and is just calling you pastor, it must be confirmed by the scripture. Qualification for the Christian ministry. Yes, that's what you need to do. Qualification for Christian ministry is clearly presented in scripture. No one who is not qualified is expected in the public ministry of the church. Apostle Paul clearly stated these qualifications in his epistle to Timothy and to Titus. Look at it in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1 to verse 13. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1 to verse 13. The Bible tells us here, saying, this is a true saying. If a man desires the office of a bishop, he desired a good work. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach, not given to wine nor striker, not greedy or filthy lucre, but patient, not a brawler, not covetous, one that ruled well his own house, having his children in subjection with all gravity. For if a man knoweth not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God? Not a novice, lest being lifted up with pride, he fall into the condemnation of the devil. Moreover, he must have a good report of them which are without, lest he fall into reproach and the snare of the devil. Likewise must the deacons be grave, not double-tongued, not given to much wine, not greedy or filthy lucre, holding the mystery of the faith in a pure conscience. And let these also first be proved. Then let them use the office of a deacon, being found blameless. Even so must their wives be grave, not slanderers, sober, faithful in all things. Let the deacons be the husbands of one wife, ruling their children and their own houses well. For they that have used the office of a deacon well purchase to themselves a good degree and great boldness in the faith which is in Christ Jesus. These things write I unto thee, hoping to come unto thee shortly. Verse 15. But if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth, and without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory. Say amen. Can you see? If any man desires ministry, office of a bishop, a preacher, a teacher, a pastor, an office, you will sit there and rule and walk. Others will walk under you. Yes, it's a good desire, but there's qualification. There's qualification. The one qualification is you must be blameless. You must be blameless. That's God. Actually, if you die and have blame in your life as a minister, you answer question before God. God will ask you, why did you go into the ministry? You have blame in your life. Like all this masturbation that you're talking about. Do you know you shouldn't go into ministry with masturbation? All this falling into fornication and rising. Do you know you shouldn't go into ministry with adultery and fornication? All this lust you're having, all this pride you demonstrate, all this lie you tell. Do you know you're not supposed to go into ministry with these things in your life? Because you have blame. You have blame. Are you seeing me? Are you seeing what I'm saying? These people you're sending to the ministry, are they clean? Are they free from immorality? Are they free from masturbation? Are they free from drunkenness? Do they tell the truth? Do they tell the truth? Are they people that can give good account of the work or tell lies? God will not walk with them. Whatever they do is carnal, for like begets like. They will give birth to things of their kind. That's what the Lord is saying. It's a spiritual formula. A bishop must be blameless. Now, this unemployment that has stricken the nation, nations have increased pastors in the churches, have increased general overseers in the field, because nobody is resisting you. How to do it? Go and raise up a church somewhere and put a signboard there. It's already, and be clapping your hand inside. People will be passing by. Oh, is there a church here? They say yes. Okay, they enter in. That's how it begins. That's what this lack of job is. The ones is affecting the ministry. It's affecting the quality of the Christian ministry. It's making people no more to consider standard. This hunger and taste of greatness that Satan has put into men has affected the ministry. Everybody now puts in dick and hurry because he wants to say, I have a branch in Nigeria, I have a branch in this country, I have a branch in America, I have a branch in this, I have a branch in Thailand, I have a... That pride of man has affected the ministry because the man himself is not in Christ. So they begin to put people there, put their wives there. That woman that is giving you trouble, is she able to be in ministry with you? That you're folding her is family business. This is what affected Christianity. It collapsed Christianity. But a new generation is rising up. We will respect this scripture to ensure you must qualify. We don't want to spread beyond that which the Lord has allowed. We don't want to spread beyond our faith, beyond our strength. If you stretched a tube beyond its capacity, it will cut. Let's follow according to the measure of faith, according to the grace the Lord gives us. That grace will increase by and by, but let's go by it. Let's go by grace, so that this work will not collapse. Look at what the Lord is saying here. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife. These chapter leaders, have you checked on them? Are they the husbands of one wife? What about the history? Have you checked their history? Have you checked their history to know that they have never married before? Have you checked the history of their wives to ensure they never married before? Because they must be husband of one wife. And this one wife, remember, Abraham married Sarah. Somebody else married Sarah out of Abraham. And the Lord said, restore Abraham his wife. Restore Abraham his wife. It means they live happily, joyfully with the wife of your youth. I mean, that woman that you got married to from the beginning. I mean, real marriage. That's the one why. Any other one, addition to it, makes you an adulterer. You can never be a pastor as an adulterer. These church members that don't even judge their pastors. They don't judge their pastors. Pharisee troubled Jesus. They judged him very well. Judged him to where he was born. Judged everything. And they didn't get the record well, so they were angry with him. But you are not judging your pastors. You're not checking to ensure they qualify. Don't you know the Bible says, when the blind leads the blind, what happens to them? They fall into the ditch. You're not checking up their lives. You're allowing them to live in it with various blames. He said, no, it's our pastor. God called him. Maybe really God called him yesterday, like Judas. But his ministry is overtaken. He's now a traitor. It's now an evil man. And as I told you, there is no eternal security in Christian ministry. What do I mean by eternal security? Once a preacher, ever a preacher, never in the Bible. Never. When Miriam committed sin, they removed him up. Go and be outside the gate. Until there is full repentance. Until there is full recovery. Hey, in the early church, when you are going somewhere, they will write a letter to authenticate you. Otherwise, Jesus knows what is in man. Even when man claims, I believe in Jesus, showing zeal, the Bible said the Lord did not commit himself to man, to them. Because he does not need anybody to tell him about man. He knows what is in man. Man that heart will be hiding sin in his heart. And will neatly be smoking. And when he smokes and knows that his mouth will smell smoke, he's licking tom-tom, licking some sweet that will cover it up. This man, Jesus knows him. Jesus knows him. Therefore, check even the preacher you're inviting. Is he in Christ? Is he remaining in Christ? Otherwise, you'll be doing service of fools without benefit. The Spirit ministers to the Spirit. He that is born of the Spirit, who is he? He is Spirit. And he that is born of the flesh, who is he? He is flesh. If you have these ones that have not been called by God to be running, to be doing this work, it will be fleshy service. Fleshly. They fight with their wives in the room. Boop, 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 boop. After that, they go to preach. Which message? So, a husband of one wife, that's what the Bible says. It must be. If he divorces his wife and remarried, his ministry has ended forever. The certificate of ministry given to him has been removed by God. Whatever he's doing now, he's a dismissed policeman. He's just putting on the uniform of the old time and is moving in the village. And people are afraid. People are afraid because they have not gotten real information. But there is no government authority backing him. He is dismissed. That's what you understand. God dismissed him. No authority is backing him. And therefore there can be no real service that can be done that will take people to heaven. So, can you see the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach. Vigilant. Somebody that's very watchful on spiritual matters. Watchful. And is a patient, self-controlled person. Not emotional. Self-control. Having the ability to teach, to preach. Ability must be there. Ability must be there. Having the ability to do it. And it continues. It says, not given to wine, nor striker, not greedy or filthy lucre, but patient, not a brawler, not covetous. It's not a money monger. Money. Until all people's attention is cut off. All people's attention. Such a pastor is wondering why we have not collected offerings since we came here. See, this is about wasting money here. And they have enough scriptures to quote to tell you that we're not doing the will of God in this place because we're not collecting money. They have enough scriptures. Money monger. It's mine is some money. All your money. Very money. Structures that you don't need. He will want to build it because he's a carnal man. It will give him glory. It will make him, promote him among pastors. The type of car he should not be riding, he needs it. Because it will give him place among pastors. It's not everybody. These things, that's why they are going to hell. With their multitudes. They're moving to hell. The pastor is not qualified and the member doesn't read the Bible, so he doesn't know the standard of a man of God. The standard of a pastor. The members are not aware. Blind people are gathered somewhere and they give them name, Church of the Living God. They are gathered somewhere, getting ready for hell. Satan is the inspirator there. So, but a person that is well-charactered, a pastor must be well-charactered. Well-charactered. What is happening in the world today is according to the adage, where in the world of the blind, the one-eyed man is the king. That is what is happening now. The one-eyed man. When the people are all blind there, and there's one man who manages to see with one eye, he's their leader. He's not seeing well. He doesn't have the fullness of sight. But actually, he's the leader. And of course, what do you do? At least he can direct people. He can direct, but not in complete sight. Very dangerous. Anything in the other side of the eye, he will not see. And that thing may be dangerous. So these are the pastors we have now. The one-eyed men, they are not fully qualified. In the register of God, they are second class. They are there by divine wisdom. Let them grow together. Divine wisdom. That's why they're there. Not qualified for ministry. So that's what I am letting you to know this. It is God that said, come here, I want to speak to you. That's why I'm speaking. He said, verse 4. One that ruled well his own house, having his children in subjection with all gravity. For if a man knew not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God? No, he can take care. He knows how to command people there. That man is powerful. He knows how to keep everybody silent. He can use a cane. Why did you come late? Kneel down there. Kneel down there. You came late? Hey, not in this church. Ask Ken. Is it what we call hawk jump? Jump. Members of the church are seeing Barak. Their leader is a captain in the army. You see him beating people. Wow! Hey, Pastor, I won't come late again. I won't come late again. And they fall on Sunday. Maybe you're coming to that church for the first time. You came. They say the church is starting 8 o'clock. To your surprise, you came 10 minutes to after 8. The church has filled up. He said, there's a man of God here. Yes, there is a man of God in court. That is there. Carnal man. Destitute of the grace of God. Without call. Without divine call. Using principles. Wisdom of man. The power of man. To control the church. Now, when the ruler well his own house, do pastors bother anymore about his house? About their house? Having his children in subjection with all gravity, do they bother more anymore about the behavior of the children? Are the children told this, that they are the certificate of their father in ministry? Or because the father went to theological school? Is the wife told this, that she is a certificate of the ministry of her husband? Or, my husband is qualified. By what? Human standard? Why? That ruleth well his own house. For, will I hide from Abraham that which I do? Seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great nation, and that all these things I have said, I will bring it upon him, will be done upon him. Why? I know Abraham. That he will command his children and his household after him, that they will learn the word of the Lord, that these things will come to pass in his life. I know Abraham. Has that God changed? Has that God, did he bless Abraham in vain? Didn't Abraham qualify? Why are you seeking blessing outside the gate? Why are you not inside? You're managing. Many are called, but few are chosen. That is it. Many. Maybe you didn't understand this before. Having his children Wife, come, wife of pastor, were you told that you are the certificate of your husband in ministry before the living God? If you were told, are you purposely fighting God by being so stubborn to your husband to give him a bad record? Are you purposely fighting the cause of God that called your husband into ministry? Do you know that true preachers are very few? Among the 300, your husband is there. And it is you that want to disqualify? Then you are an enemy of God. You and Satan are the same. You are fighting the cause of Christ. You are wasting the crucifixion of Jesus. You are wasting the suffering of Christ. Because you are disqualifying those that will spread this gospel. Children, were you told? Children of pastors, that you can't be like other people. They commit immorality. They go to dance in the disco hall. They're the best dancers. Have you been told that you are the certificate of your father? That you can spoil the ministry of that man? Or because you have not been told, maybe the man himself is not even aware that you were certificate. They didn't tell you. They didn't tell you. But their qualifications. That's why no man taketh this honor unto himself, but they that were called, or are called of God, as the Lord called Aaron. Because he knows those who are qualified. Not Eliab. Not Eliab. Not Shammah. But David. Because God judges according to the intent of the heart. Content of the heart. Yes. Not a novice. Lest, being lifted up with pride, he fall into the condemnation of the devil. Not a novice. Oh, I have got experience. I have received divine revelation. I repented from occultism. The next thing is church. From divine experience. Jesus appeared to me yesterday, today, church. The church of Jesus' appearances. What have you known about him? You saw the image of Jesus. Has he been formed in your heart? Have you understood what you saw? You saw the living Jesus. But what about the written one? Which is standard? Is revelation more than doctrine? What doctrine do you feed the people? With prophecies? You'll be feeding them. And these human beings, let them say Jesus appeared to a small child. It's like these other people, they say, Mary appeared to somewhere in Benue State. Catholics left at their countries from various places and flock in that place to see Mary. And there is true one small girl. That's man. That's man. They don't do the qualification of the scriptures. You shift attention to the people with divine revelation. Do they know the scripture? Have they matured in scripture? It's because you're looking for miracle. You're looking for healing. You're looking for prophecy. You're looking for revelation. Are you even ready to do the revelation? Are you ready? Can you imagine what we're saying? Is somebody answering yes there? Do you understand what I'm saying? So let's keep our comments. Is that clear? So that's what I'm saying to you. Not a novice. That man that has just come in, just repented 2 months ago, is now your assistant pastor. What has he known? Has he been tried? Has he passed the temptations of life? Has he been challenged? Can you climb on a tree that is just growing up? If you put your leg, you break it. Put your leg there, it will break. It will take years for that tree to produce branches and be mature enough for you to climb up.
You don't know this? That all these zealous people who just came yesterday, you are giving them mighty positions.
Satan will take over that church.
Because that's what the Bible says. Not a novice. And you just came up. You just came up from this, your church. You have not learned yet. You want to go and start a church. You want to go and start a church? You are not ready to learn. You just repented. Just repented now. Enough to be a pastor? Enough to be a pastor? Not a novice. Lest pride will come in. I know there can be special circumstances where the Lord has been training you longer. You have been in Christ longer. And you have been keeping holiness longer. That can be a special circumstance, but it's not everybody. No. But just come from church like that, you're going to start a church? No. Learn. Be a disciple. Sit under teachers and learn from them. So speak under teachers until the Lord calls you. You must mature. Otherwise, all these sins that you're falling into is because of your immaturity. That's what the Bible is saying. Moreover, he must have a good report of them which are without, lest he fall into reproach and the snare of the devil. The people around should give a good report about you. The people around, there are pastors that people say, is Saul also among the prophets? Because they know Saul. They know your life. They know Saul. For them, Saul just repented. The Holy Spirit came upon him. They are not aware. That's why they are complaining. It means you must be somebody people should know. They are putting their own trust for eternal life on you. And they see the way you're living your life there. If you're into business, cheats, lies, pastor. Three things go together. No, Bible says not for God. Not for God. Yes. Likewise, must the deacons be grave, not double-tongued, not given to much wine. Much wine is not alcohol. It's just the normal wine. Jesus turned water into the normal wine, sweet drink. But it's not just given to pleasures. Not given to these pleasures. Not given to much wine. Not greedy or filthy lucre. Not greedy. Money, money, money. You go to count money, you put some in your pocket. And say, God understands. God understands with you. How has he understood with Satan? So, that's what God wants you to know. There is qualification. Don't take ministry anyhow and put it in your pocket and be going. For they that have used, verse 11. Even so must their wives be grave, not slanderers, sober, faithful in all things. Wife of ministers, do you know you're not like an ordinary woman that can tell stories and entertain people with it? People sit around you, laugh. Some of those things, are they not slanders? Are they not exaggerations? Because in multitude of words, there lacketh no sin. You should be great. People should look at you and see life and see heaven in your life. The Bible says, even a fool, if he holds his peace, shall be esteemed as a man of wisdom. Silence gives honor to a person. Even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of God of great price. But you are a noisemaker. You are a noisemaker. You're bringing disapproval to your husband's ministry. You are bringing it. Because you can't control yourself. Do you know that that position of being a wife of a pastor, is a delicate position. There's much reward, there's much judgment. That's what you need to understand. Qualification is there. Yes. Verse 12. Let the deacons be the husbands of one wife, ruling their children and their own houses well. You have double function. The ministry, the house. But start from the house. For judgment must first begin at the house. Start from the house. Put your house in order. Do all the prayer and fasting you're doing for miracle. One, do a prayer and fasting for a house suitable for the ministry. This is a serious case. Very serious case. Because the Lord is the one saying it. Of course, we know there's stubbornness in our time. Children can go off, but let them not go off because you didn't train them. A child is at the age of free will, can choose what to do. Let his blood be upon himself. But the child that is under your control, that the Lord knows, if you take your responsibility, that child will change. If you open up your voice and be serious, that child will change. And you are doing nothing, you are responsible. There is the God of justice in heaven that knows a lazy pastor and knows a pastor facing the challenge of the devil and challenge of circumstances. There's a God in heaven. But be just. Be just in your house. Be just. Let God justify your effort, that indeed you have made effort. Everybody will know. But then, you will still join it with delicate, high position in ministry. You have a compromising family. That one will leave it between you and God. But the scripture has said it. What is he saying? Rule your house well. Rule your house well. Understand this and cry to God. He will change your family. Qualification. Look at it in Titus chapter 1, verse 5 to verse 9. For this cause, leave I thee in Crete, that thou shouldest set in order the things that are wanting, and ordain elders in every city as I had appointed thee. If any be blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of riot or unruly. For a bishop must be blameless, as the steward of God, not self-willed, not soon angry, not given to wine, not no striker, not given to filthy lucre, but a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, sober, just, holy, temperate, holding fast the faithful word, as he had been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. Now, I left you in Crete. You have appointed a leader to appoint others. The Lord gave you the office of a general overseer, general superintendent, senior pastor, that you should appoint others, but he gave you the qualification. Don't leave God and go to form your kingdom. Because the glory of the king is in the multitude of his subjects. Don't go and be seeking your glory. Don't run faster than God. If you have not gotten people to appoint, be peaceful and patient. For Jesus was on earth for 33 and a half years. He started the ministry at 30. At 15, he could do it. At 10, even at 5. But he waited. Weren't there people dying? The God of heaven is a God of time and order. If the time has not come for that place, if you have not found the appropriate person, stay until there is a moving in the mulberry trees. Until there is a moving on the top of the trees, then go forth. Until the Holy Spirit takes his time and is moving now, follow him. Maybe the man is yet to be transferred to that place. The man the Lord has appointed, for no man taketh this honor to himself. He's yet to come up. Therefore, don't appoint people without considering these conditions. Don't. To appoint elders in every city. But if a man be blameless, the husband of one wife, it means investigation is important. Asking report on a person, how he is important. The husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of riot or unruly. The children must also contribute to this gospel by godly character, not wayward children. The man is good, but the children are corrupt. Don't appoint him. Don't, for his children's sake. Yes. For a bishop must be blameless. Blameless. The God that specifies qualifications will raise people, give grace for people to qualify. He will raise up this time for people because he is interested in spreading his kingdom. He will raise them up. He said, whom can we find now that he can fulfill this condition? Then stop the ministry in that place. Or else stop your whole ministry, because your whole ministry doesn't have originality in it. Now, we find these women that are coming up with zeal. Women are coming up with zeal. I have a ministry. You are jumping up and down. Are you in control of your husband? Are you in subjection to your husband? Are your children behaving well? Do you treat your husband fine? Are you submissive to your husband? Or you're stronger than your husband? You lock him up at the room before you go out now to be doing morning call. Hey, Jesus is coming, Jesus is coming. Who gave you that assignment? You think it's every mouth that says it has meaning? That it can produce results? Full of ministry without life. Women, originality is expected of you. It is our prayer to God. All our women leaders, our coordinators, the Lord will examine them. Anyone that is not qualified will leave that place. This is not my work. It's God's work. We want to spread quickly. He that hasteneth with his feet sinneth. If you hasten for God, you will commit sin. Allow it to grow as the Lord inspires it. Therefore, those that are not qualified, that are not living well, that are not behaving well, expose them. Expose them. We shall investigate it. And there's no respect of person with God. There's no respect of person. We're not counting on your number of years of doing that thing. A sickness can be there for 20 years. It's still there. After 20 years, still there. You can have a fault. You have been carrying all this while. So, qualify. Be blameless. It's a serious case. Very serious case. You are called a minister? Not a simple thing. Not a simple thing. The Lord is restoring the honor of ministry. The honor of ministry. The Lord is restoring the honor of his ministers. But he's coming upon the few that qualify. coming upon the few that qualify. These are the people the Lord will honor. Haman, the king told you that what will he do to the man that he honors? You think you are the son? You is you? It's not Haman. Haman said, whom will the king honor more than myself? Who again will the king honor? Please help me tell Haman that he's not himself. A murderous man like that wants to be honored. A wicked man like that wants to be honored. You want to come in and be a minister in holiness movement with your wickedness, with your evil, with your life, and say God will honor you. He will never honor you. That honor is for Mordecai, a man chosen by God according to the predestined knowledge of God, a servant of God, a Jew with eternal future, the one that has the passion for his God. That is the man the Lord will honor. That is the man the Lord will honor. So see the qualification here. For a bishop must be blameless as the steward of God, not self-willed, not soon angry. You are a little thing, you're angry. I said, this anger is troubling our families. I'm not the only one. Then you're not qualified for the Christian ministry. You're not. It's an inheritance. Satanic inheritance. And you didn't deal with it. And you're busy running for ministry with anger. Little thing. Like a terrible dog in the house. You are not qualified. Anger has disqualified you. Anger. Not soon angry. Because you cannot be like our God that is very patient. You will scatter his people with your anger. Church, is your pastor easily angry? Does little thing provoke him? How does it happen? For how long now? Then you have been under a wrong person. You have been under a wrong person. He's not qualified to be your pastor. Never. Not for heaven. Maybe he's distributing money for you in the church. That's why you're there. Otherwise, not for your soul. He is not qualified. That anger has disqualified him. You woman, wife or pastor, you are easily angry. Our mama in the church. Mama anger. Never for that church. Not for the good of that church. Your anger has disqualified you. Not soon angry. You must go and labor to qualify. And not sit king. No, an angry man is a proud man. Anger and pride go together. Then how are you? You don't have the righteousness of God. Why are you pastoring? Who asked you to do it? You don't qualify. You climb through the window. He that does not pass through the door, but climbed the other side, the same is a thief and a robber. You are doing destruction in the world, in the church. Destruction is what you're doing there. Because of your anger. Because of your pride. You make the children of God to sit under bondage under you. You remove the Holy Spirit from their lives. They are in fear. You make them imperfect. Because he that feareth is not made perfect in love. And you cause the fear. Your anger has caused that fear. Your anger has caused fear. That's what you need to understand. Christian ministry, what a noble job. What a great job. Yes. That's what he's saying. But he should be a lover of hospitality. A lover of good men. Sober, just, holy, temperate, self-control, holy man. A lover. He can do good. He's able to answer, to control himself. In times of tension, he can control himself. The tongue of the learned studieth to answer. Even in tension, he's teaching, God, what do I say here? It's not lie that will come out to free himself at that moment. No. words of righteousness, words of wisdom. That's what the Lord is saying. Verse 9, holding fast the faithful word, as he hath been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. Holding forth the faithful word, our coordinators that are here must hold to this word. Those that are doing another thing, they are not qualified. Those that are chapter leaders and you're teaching another thing that we're not teaching here, you're not qualified. May God take note of you. May God show us where you are. You're not supposed to be here. You're not supposed to be our teacher. You're supposed to be a learner. It's not your size of body. It's not the height of your life. It is your heart. A man after God's heart. Doing it as he has been taught. You're here, you feel you know more than me. That's pride. You could know more. Yes, I can know everything. But no, that's himself. He doesn't know. Why didn't you come? Why did you check up with me? Why didn't you share with me what you know? To see, to examine it, or to humbly teach me, so that I can employ it and use it to bless others. You're so proud that you cannot do the things we're instructing you to do. You are not qualified. You are not. You are not supposed to be in that place. Let God show us where you are. You are not supposed to be there. That's the word. Holding forth the faithful word. All these teachings on jewelry, women palming, restitutions, and all this. You say you're not convinced yet. Then who asks you to be a leader? Who asks you to accept? We made a mistake. Even Samuel made a mistake. In five, God didn't intervene. Shammah would have been, Eliab would have been the king. Israel would have suffered. That would have been a fleshly king. So we made a mistake to put you there. Oh God, where is he? Father, where is she? We met somebody, a leader, that is a distraction to the walk. It's not convinced of doctrines of soundness, doctrines of scripture, the truth, the word of holiness. He's not convinced. So he's doing his own. And the members are sitting there. You don't know that you're on your way to hell. He said, I'm holiness moving. Is holiness moving eternal life? Is holiness moving the name that saves? You see wrong things going on. That this man has left the standard of God. You sat down there and say, holiness movement. And say, I fear him. And let him not say that I am the one spoiling his ministry. Even you yourself, the door of heaven has been closed against you. Because you don't love this Jesus. Somebody is blocking another person from seeing Jesus. And you are hiding him. The two of you are the same. The two of you are the same. That's what you should understand. This is the qualification. It's not anyhow. Maybe we started wrongly. And some of you were scaffold that were used to build a house. When they finished the house, they removed the scaffold. I want to tell you this. God can use you in his wisdom. He knows that you're not qualified. But in the land of the blind, the one that can see small, can be the leader. At least can see the Broadway. You can see how people can pass for a while. But when you have gotten the original, he takes over. That is what you need to understand. You were not born to be a leader. You were not born to be a pastor. You are not born to be a coordinator. You are not born to be a preacher. You preach by qualification. The moment you cease in qualifying, ministry stops. That is the church of the living God. That ye may know how to behave yourself in the church of the living God. The pillar and ground of truth. That's what the word of God is teaching us. And we must come back to it. We must come back to it. Yes. The reason for non-compliance to scriptural standard is because many of these churches are not under the control of the Holy Spirit. Their founders are in control and run it in their way to achieve their aims. True revival and unity of the churches cannot be possible except there is a return to scriptural standard for the Christian ministry. How can we say, oh, let's come together and be one with all these various people? They put demons as pastors. Snakes are pastoring people. And then you say we should come together. It's not possible. Everybody says it's not possible. It's not. So, the revival of this end time is not denominational togetherness. Come everybody from every denomination. Come together. Do you know what atrocities are going on in those places? Do you know how long they left the standard of God? Do you even know how their foundation was? If the foundation is out of course, what's the hope of the righteous? It means, therefore, if there must be revival of Christian unity, I'm telling you, denominationalism must be backed. And we should go back to the Bible. Because if we are bent on bringing denominations together, what about these atrocities? Who is their president? Do you know that some of their presidents is demon that gave them? Demons put them there. I heard of one of these big churches during election of who is going to be the president. I was told that the man who wanted to be the president went to an idol worshiper to ask power, to command authority on others. They will submit to him. You think Jesus will not allow it? Is he among them? Didn't he say, let the dead bury their dead? Now, you think to bring such a man and say, okay, let's recognize, oh ministers, I'm telling you, if we go that way, we cannot achieve revival. We will not. It is the revival based on the doctrines of truth, the standard of truth that is followed. Every man shall be examined by the scripture. Every man, you must change and comply. Otherwise, you cannot form the team of end time revival. You cannot, because you don't know him. You're out of course. You are not qualified. You can't preach the end time message because you're not sent. That's what you need to understand. Yes. Divine grace for ministry. Now, divine grace for ministry. In the book of Ephesians, chapter 3. Ephesians, chapter 3. I read verse 1 to verse 12. For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ for you Gentiles, if ye have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me to you all, how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote afore in few words, whereby when ye read, ye may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel, whereof I was made a minister, according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his power. Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ, to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church The manifold wisdom of God, according to the eternal purpose, which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of Christ. Christian ministry is the greatest and most noble duty or service that can be performed in this world. Yes, but the calling and grace for this is by God, who is the one to be served. The one. The ruler chooses those that will rule with him. All that the Lord has been doing, he is choosing those that will rule with him to eternity. The king, when a president comes up, he dissolves the existing cabinet and chooses those that will rule with him. It's God that makes this choice. It's God that gives this calling. Qualify. Qualify. Apostle Paul declared outrightly that his calling and apostleship were by God himself. Look at it, Romans. Romans chapter 1, verse 1. Romans chapter 1, verse 1. The Bible tells us here, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God. Servant, first born again. Servant of Jesus Christ. Then, called to be an apostle. That title apostle is an office that it is God that calls people into it. You find somebody who rise up and say, I am apostle this. How did you, which way? God gave it to you? What makes you, why are you people doing like this? This is a rank that is God that gives people. You just carry this rank and put on yourself. And wherever you come, they say, okay, oh, it's an apostle, it's an apostle, it's an apostle, give him place. You will pay for that. That confusion you have set into the kingdom of God among the ministers, you will pay for that. Because where Apostle Paul appears, the ear follows him. The spiritual ear and spiritual authority of his rank goes with him. Who gave you that position? Now, go again. Go again. To the book of Ephesians, I mean Corinthians. 1 Corinthians, chapter 1, verse 1. The Bible says, Paul, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God and sustains our brother. Can you get this place? The offices are given by the will of God. The offices of apostle, of prophet, they are given by the will of God. Those offices. So, Paul called to be an apostle, but he didn't mention that Sustains was an apostle. But Sustains was with him. To tell you that it's not anybody. No man taketh this honor to himself. Sustains never was apostle. Paul never called him an apostle. He says, our brother. I want you to come back to biblical principle. Biblical truth. You're confusing things. You're turning the church upside down. There's a confused noise. Good, see it again. In 2 Corinthians, chapter 1, verse 1, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timothy our brother. Why not Apostle Timothy? Has your ministry gone to the point of Timothy that you have become an apostle now? Or you think you just carry honor? No man giveth this, taketh this honor to himself. But they that are called by God, as was Aaron, prophet this, apostle this. That's what is going on now to make market. That's what is going on now. Go to Galatians chapter 1. Verse 1, Paul. Now let's read that one together. Are you there? Galatians chapter 1, verse 1. Let's go there now. Because some atrocities are going on among men, rendering, defacing the Christian ministry. Defacing it. Making the Holy Spirit to abandon it. Because it's not according to his pattern. Are you there in Galatians chapter 1, verse 1? 1, 2, go. Paul, an apostle, not of men, neither by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead. There is no anything of people that is given ranks and titles that gave Paul this title of apostleship. He said, not by man. Not, he said, not by men. A group of men who have their own apostle, bishop class. Bishop group. Chaired by one man. And he said, he wants to increase those ones. So everybody, bishop. The bishop that is free, which means pastor, elder, now you buy it with money. That one you bought with money is an accursed thing. You bought with money. You have left God. You are not in the class of holy people. You bought your own with money. It's a group of people going about giving people. They're the ones going about giving people titles that gave you that title. It's not that you were recognized with it. That gave you the title of apostleship. Paul said, not by men. Not by men. No group of people confer it unto me. It is God and Jesus and the Father. What Jesus and the Father does, man, you come into it. What Jesus and the Father gives, you're seeking it from men. You have left Jesus and the Father. That title you're bearing is not in the register of heaven. It came out of your carnal mind. Seeking authority on the earth. Get it, because you have none over there. That's what we're telling you. Carrying titles. I'm prophet. I'm apostle. Who met you? He said, neither by man, not of men, a team of people, nor by man. My general overseer has given me the title apostle. Paul said, no general man gave him that title. No general man gave him that title. Be very careful with these titles. Seeking these titles. Be careful. You leave the work and you're going for mere name. Can a name serve the people? Is it everybody that bore prophet? Is it everybody? Is it of works? You dream a dream and the dream came to pass. You say, I'm apostle this. I am prophet this. You have been looking for it, so Satan gave you. That dream that you dreamed came from Satan. Because you have been looking for that office of a prophet. Hey! And you begin to now make assumptions and be telling people. Telling people lies on the prophet. Go and remove those things from your life. Burn them. The certificate they gave you, go and burn it before it carries you to hellfire. So that's what we're saying. That is it. That is it. But do you see, a pastor, I will give you pastors Who is a pastor? A shepherd. It's not just an office, but the leader of God's people. The general title, pastor. Evangelist, according to his calling, as what we can see the gift in him. According to his calling, and that which we can see as a gift. Prophet, it must be pronounced. It must be a pronounced thing. Before they called him prophet Agabus, he was known with it. God put that authority on him. Apostle, are all apostles? You know, the authority of God over churches, the Lord gave it to him. God gave it to him, and you will know it. No man taketh this honor unto himself. But he that is called of God, as was Aaron. Yes. That's what you need to understand. But you see, divine grace and ministry given to a man or woman is not for his or her honor and pride. Those given ministry by God who go into pride will witness emptiness and the fall. As seen in Apostle Paul, grace for ministry will attract grace for service. For grace is given for grace. Grace is given for grace. You are going to understand this. When God gives you grace and calls you, he will give you grace for the work. Let me tell you a little thing which only few people knew. Because I ran so much, go here for this program, go here for this program, I became exceedingly tired as this program approached. I didn't know how will I preach one message here. I didn't know. I was too tired. Sincerely, I want to say so that you can also learn my mistakes too. The last place I went, maybe I wouldn't have gone. I would have spent more time here. I'll spend more time to have strength. But I thought that the period I had consecrated before me would be enough. I never knew that the body would not take that. I became so tired. Tired, what will I do? I kept on praying. God, in fact, I gave prayer request. God, how do we do it now? I know I preach with gesticulation and demonstration. Then, this tiredness that has entered into my bone, how can I do anything? And people are coming from every part of various parts of the country, of the world, country and the world. How do I do this thing now? Thank God the prayer warriors were praying. The Lord bless them. They have done special work in this conference. The Lord bless them. In Jesus' name. Then what happened is, on Wednesday morning, I woke up with a strength I could not explain how it came. With perfect strength. I became so strong. I said, I'm strong. I can preach. Praise the Lord. Have the preaching been going on well? I say, has it been going on well? Grace for grace. Of his fullness have we all received. And grace for grace. The Lord has given me grace for this war. He will give me grace to do it. The Lord give you grace for grace. Grace for grace. that which he has assigned you to do, may he give you grace to do it well. That is why no man taketh dishonor to himself. Where would you have recovered? How? If God was not involved in that appointment, that you just went and carried it and put upon your head, I am international director, you will collapse. In the evil day, how will you stand? How will you stand? But God is interested in the calling he has given to me. And he knew how tired I was. He said, I am your strength. I am your strength. Let the weak say, I am strong. For because God is behind him. God has given him the assignment. He will give him the strength. That is it. That is what you need to understand. Yes, God's divine grace also supplied Paul with the peace, courage, boldness, and ability to bear persecution, hardship, pains, fatigue, wants, abundance, and situations suitable or unsuitable in the ministry. In this way, he is able to run the ministry successfully to the end. Yes, Moses' father-in-law came and saw Moses counseling from evening, from morning till evening. He pitied Moses. He pitied him. But the Lord revealed later that the Holy Spirit in Moses was sufficient, equal to what Moses was doing. Moses could do that and survive it because grace for grace. Such that even when Moses does say, oh, it's true, Lord, please get other people to do it with me, the Lord had to take of the Spirit in Moses and give to 70 others. And yet, greater quantity still remain in him. To tell you, the man that God calls, he gives grace. You might be pitying him. He has grace. He can do those things. The news, the bad news, the evil news, the disappointment, the challenges, the backbiting, the gossips that are coming, and so on. He is able to bear them because he has sufficient grace. Look at it in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. I read from verse 7. Unless I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan, to buffet me. Lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. Let's read verse 9 together. 1, 2, go. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Can you see that? Can you see it? For my grace is sufficient for all those persecutions, those challenges of life, those weaknesses you feel, the sicknesses, call them what you call them, that whatever they are, my grace. Don't be concerned of attack. Nothing will happen to you. Move forward. The grace of God is sufficient for you. Don't bother yourself about the criticism that the people are making about you. No, don't bother. Move forward. The grace of God will take care of those critics. I say grace will take care of those critics. Move forward. forward and serve your God. My grace is sufficient for you. If it's not grace, by strength can no man prevail. He will help you. See how he's improving your ministry now. By giving you this knowledge. See how he's bringing transformation to your life. By bringing you this understanding. Because understanding shall keep you. Now that you have learned these things, you are going to walk on them. And the grace will be given you for the grace of hearing these things. And you will see, dead bones shall rise again. Dry bones shall rise again. All your hopelessness shall be turned to a beauty, a strength, a progress, and a brighter future for your life. Grace for grace. That's what the Lord is saying. Therefore, Paul said, most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. This thing was practicalized on me. So, it is, it became so real in my life. I was so weak, I became so strong. That's God. That's God. Seek the will of God and get it and stand there. You will enjoy grace for grace. I'm saying this so that you humble yourself. Because our minds are thinking great things. Seek ye great things for yourself. Seek them not. Rather seek the will of God. What God wants. What he wants you to do. That is what you should seek. Finally, receiving divine grace and ministry. You who have not received a true ministry from God, but desire to serve him, you can obtain one here. And those who have received ministry from God, but need grace, need more grace, abundant grace, exceeding grace, exceeding abundant grace, you can receive it from God. You can receive it by following the following scriptures, scriptural instructions. Number one, purge yourself. Purge. Clean yourself. Purify yourselves. Yourself. In the book of 2 Timothy, chapter 2, verse 19 to 21, the Bible says, nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his, and let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. But in a great house, they are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also of wood and of earth, and some to honor, and some to dishonor. If a man therefore purge himself from this, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. If a man therefore purge himself, if a man therefore purge himself from this. Your case, you went down to the valley to the point that you are not even on the surface level. You went down to be operating with demons for ministry. Have you visited Ghana before? Did you apply to India? For ministry. The other man there. You had the story of that other man. What about those within Nigeria? Did they give you power? All this, their own anointing oil. Did you buy? Are you selling with them? You went down. You went down. I mean, beyond the surface level. Others backslid and remain on top, but you dropped down. You went to meet with Satan. You are running ministry. You have put something in your mouth now. There's something that is, in fact, they say they take bath with honey. Maybe you took bath with honey so that your words will be sweet. I'm not sure it's ordinary honey because you can't do that. It's not ordinary honey. You went to that point. You wash your face with water. You wash your face with water. You went to a particular minister who uses these things. You visited that man in Lagos and received anointing, demonic anointing. If a man purge himself from this, if you can ask for the blood of Jesus and get yourself thoroughly purged from this, that altar must be destroyed again, excavated. Call Holiness Movement, will help you. Is that okay? Call Holiness Movement. That they should help you because you buried the head of a dog at the pulpit. You buried this, you buried that. Don't be ashamed. Satan has taken people farther than you. Satan has taken people farther than you. Therefore, don't be ashamed. Expose the devil. Expose the devil and he will be ashamed and Jesus shall take glory. Purge those things off from your life. What about you? Your power is in more immorality. The more you commit immorality, the more power. I had a story of a pastor. He was doing miracle. He came to preach a miracle. Hey, in Jesus' name. Everybody was falling down. The children were saying, pastor has committed, daddy has committed fornication today. He has committed fornication today. Because his power was attached to immorality. That's why from place to place, immorality, his power attached to it. Is that what is going on? You go to homosexuality for power. Power to preach. You are married to a man. Second wife. But nobody knows. He comes to stay with you as a friend, but he's a second wife. For Jesus Christ. For me, his ministry. What an abuse. The price of a dog should not be brought to the temple of God. The wages of a prostitute should never come to the house of God. Purge yourself from those things. Purge yourself. Total repentance. You say you want a new ministry? Total repentance. Total purging. Otherwise, you are in the house of God as a vessel unto dishonor. A vessel unto dishonor. They are packing sand with you. If you want to carry sand, they pack with you. Wheelbarrow. Hey. Have you seen the king sitting in wheelbarrow and they're carrying him before? You have never carried Jesus once. They are vehicles. They are vehicles. Standard vehicles that carry the king. Beautiful vehicles, but you are an instrument of dishonor. They use you to clean excreter from the ground. But you are in ministry anyway, but it's for cleaning excreter. You are like that vessel unto dishonor by which they carry excreter from the place. Purge yourself from that thing. All this corrupt ministry, going up and down, taking money. Prophesying for money. Prophesying for money. There's a prophecy for 10,000 naira. Prophecy for 20. Prophecy for 100,000. The one that can promise you that he will give you 500,000, you will sleep in his house and prophesy there. Purge yourself from that foolish type of thing. Dishonorable service to God. He that purgeth himself from this shall be used. That's the promise. a vessel unto honor. Your name will change from dishonorable uses to honorable uses. Vessel unto honor. If you can change, if you can repent and come out of that darkness, witchcraft, selling anointing oil for power, deceiving people, giving them to drink, playing some tricks. I said, this stone came from Jerusalem. This stone, this sand is from Judah. Stop those things, evil things, giving people holy water. Yeah, I have prayed on this handkerchief. This apron is anointed. You have power to anoint anything? Do you have power to anoint anything? Or you're deceiving the people? Purge yourself from those things. The Lord is looking for original ministers, for the days are few. The end time is here. The rapture is before us. You will be doing those evil things. We want original people. If you want to be one, purge yourself on this. You sit down and construct a testimony of visitation to heaven and to hell. Sit down like this and construct it. And be going about. I went to heaven, I went to hell. Because I need money. Purge yourself from these false prophets and prophecies. Those prophecies, are they inspired? Does God really give them, or you frame them? You frame them. My brethren, you know, yes, we gave attention to revelation, but our stomachs are becoming satisfied. Are you hearing what I'm saying? There's diminishing return now, because Satan has entered into the business. A lot of them, Jesus appeared to me. Oh, the Lord is speaking now. We have proved that they are lies. We have proved it. They are lies. You are getting excited at them. I don't get excited at them anymore. I don't get excited. The Lord has warned me. Say, pray very well before you accept a revelation. Pray very well. And I've learned my lessons.
So you call upon him. When you are looking for mercy, call upon him. He will answer you. Call upon him. When you are looking for mercy, call upon him. He will answer you. Call upon him. When you are looking for mercy, call upon him.
Call upon God!
He will answer you. Call upon him. When you're looking for mercy, call upon him. He will answer you. Call upon Jesus. When you are looking for mercy, oh, call upon him. He will answer you. Call upon Jesus. When you are looking for mercy, yes, call upon him. He will answer you. Call upon him. When you are looking for mercy, call upon him. He will answer you. Call upon him. When you are looking for mercy, call upon him. He will answer you.
Confess your sins. Confess your evil lie. Confess your evil ministry. Take it away from the lie. Don't go back to it anymore. Be a new creature. Be a new creature, a new man of God. You backslid, return. Prodigal son, come back home. Come back to the true ministry. You have gone after devils. You have gone after demons. Repent! Repent!
He's cracking now.
Repent! Your life. Let God have mercy.
Let the power of the Lord come down. Let the mercy of the Lord come down.
Let the mercy of the Lord from heaven come down. Let the mercy of the Lord 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 from heaven come down. Let the mercy of the Lord come down. Let the power of the Lord save you. Let the power of the Lord set you free. Let the power of the Lord from heaven set you free. Let the power of the Lord set you free. Oh Lord, let your power, oh my God, touch them. Oh power of the Lord, save them. Let the power of the Lord from heaven save them. Let the power of the Lord come down. Let the blood of Jesus cleanse them. Let the blood of Lord Jesus cleanse them. Let the blood of Jesus from heaven cleanse them. Let the blood of Jesus wash them. Hand upon your chest like the publican. Today is the day of mercy. Repeat these words. God of heaven, I have wronged you. I went into ministry without your knowledge. You didn't call me. You called me, but I failed. And began to do your work in sin. God, Satan is the one controlling me. But today I repent. Today I repent. I turn my back from the devil. And I am ready to do the right thing. Forgive me, Lord. Forgive me, God. Have mercy on me. I have come to you to receive grace. Grace unto forgiveness. Grace for this ministry. Give me your grace. Have mercy upon me. I will not be the same anymore. Any strange things I have acquired, I will destroy them. In Jesus' name. Any people I've put in bondage, I will set them free now. Hear my prayer, Lord. I don't want to go to hell. You showed me mercy by bringing me here. Show me mercy and change my life. Take away this hypocrisy from my life. Make me original. Begin to thank the Lord.
Begin to thank the Lord. Begin to thank the Lord. Begin to thank the Lord. Begin to thank the Lord. Thank the Lord for your life. Thank the Lord for your life. He has shown you mercy. He has shown you mercy. God, you have shown them mercy. God, you have shown them mercy. God, you have shown them mercy. Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Raise up your hands before the Lord. God, you brought them because you love them. I know you won't forsake them if they genuinely repent. Now, let them live again. Let them live again. In the name of Jesus. Let originality come back to them. Let them be your holy ministers. Purge them, O Lord. Destroy that satanism that had been in them. The power of evil that has been in them. The power of witchcraft. Lord, put it down in their lives. Put it down in their lives. In Jesus' name we pray.
The message you have just listened to is a production of Holiness Revival Movement Worldwide. Holiness Revival Movement Worldwide is a non-denominational ministry that is given to the propagation of Christ's righteousness and holiness in churches and nations of the world through crusades, revival meetings, production and spread of holiness literature and materials. For other spiritual materials, messages, or inquiry, contact us on 0813-635-6813 and 0805-683-4323. You can also reach us through our email address, holinessrevivalmovement@gmail.com. God bless you.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Hallelujah.
Jesus, I believe in you. You are my Lord and Savior. I believe. I believe in purchased me with your blood. You are my Lord and my Savior. You left your throne above and took up the form of a servant. Jesus, you are the living. love.